You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Say goodnight.
Goodnight.
I'll be in to tuck you in.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we have a very special guest, and I hope some of the rumors and misconceptions and lies and are all going to get cleared up, and I hope that some facts are going to come out. But either way, you're going to get to hear from somebody you haven't been able to hear from, and I think that is the most important thing at all. All of this Oklahoma City bombing rhetoric has been one-sided, and it has been a spate of propaganda, the likes of which the United States of America has never seen before in its entire history. It is reminiscent of Joseph Goebbels in Nazi Germany. I think he would be extremely proud of what he has taught the communist news networks and the Marxist, socialist, feudalist, hopeful New World robber barons. Don't go away. You're going to want to hear every word of tonight's broadcast.
Everybody roll with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows the war is over. Everybody knows the good guys lost. Everybody knows that the fight was lost. The poor single and the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows that the fool leaves you never, but I know that the captain of the hand. Everybody got this broken down, like a model that dogs just behind. Everybody wants to go to the market. Everybody wants the box of chocolates and the gong stem rose.
Well, James Nichols, welcome to the Hour of the Time.
Thank you, Bill.
I want to thank you profusely for agreeing to do this interview tonight. And I hope that we're able to get your side of the story out here the way that you would like to tell it. And I hope that we're able to clear up some of the rumors and misconceptions, outright lies, and let people know at least what it is that you believe are the true facts about the Oklahoma City bombing and the participation of your brother Terry and Tim McVeigh, if any. So,
we can try for an hour.
Wonderful. And of course,
short, but it takes a long time. But
yeah, well, if it takes that long and you want to come back, well, by golly, we'll make the time available for you.
Always willing to talk.
How did you, well, let's start off just by finding, how did you get involved in this in the first place? How did you become one of the people that America focused its attention on for at least the initial few days, if not a couple of weeks there in the beginning?
Tim, when Tim McVeigh was arrested, he gave an address as my address. He put my name down on his arrest card, supposedly. I've yet to get a copy of that, and certain people are supposed to get me a copy, and they have not gotten me a copy. I've been promised by more than one investigating reporter they'd get me a copy of it. I haven't got it yet.
Would one of those have been Larry Myers?
Ah, Steve the Devil.
He tells a lot of untruths, doesn't he?
Well, he's promised me and promised me and never delivered anything to me.
Yeah, well, let's while we're on that subject, let's get to another one. Larry Myers recently published an article and gave information to other reporters who subsequently published those articles that the Hour of the Time was the favorite shortwave radio program of Tim McVeigh and that he listened to this broadcast all the time. Is there any truth to that? And bear in mind, I have no idea whatsoever.
Yes, there is some truth to that.
Tell us about it.
I became familiar of it when Tim was staying here, off and on different times. That's where I became familiar with you.
Did he listen to this broadcast all the time?
Well, I wouldn't say all the time, but quite often.
Was it his favorite?
Chance to.
Was it his favorite broadcast?
I couldn't say whether it was his favorite or not, but it was a good one.
Uh-huh.
Liked it. I kind of liked it, too.
Well, I'm glad that you did, and I'm glad that he did. I'm glad that that all of the people who listen to this broadcast.
You had very interesting information and speakers on guest in the past. Always.
Well, the goal here is to try to...
Truth is not boring.
That's correct.
As the national media tried to portray it as.
That's correct.
We're not that stupid out here.
No, I don't believe that some Americans are that stupid. I have come to believe that the vast majority of what I call the sheeple are lost in stupidity, if you will.
Yes, yes. I educated three teenagers yesterday from a local school that came to investigate me for a psychology class.
Uh-huh.
I said, well, I'm sorry, but this is Law 101 here.
Well, let's get back to the Larry Myers thing. His intent with publishing that statement was, of course, to vilify the Hour of the Time and by implication say that the Hour of the Time led Timothy McVeigh and Terry Nichols, neither one of whom have been convicted of anything, to blow up the Mira Federal building in Oklahoma City. Do you believe that to be true?
No, but you forgot to include the Turner Diaries in that, which the government has said that's why it was blown up, because they read the Turner Diaries. And to respond to that, as I've said on Dateline and other programs, which they didn't allow to go on the air, was that... Well, then the government people got together and saw clear and present danger and blew it up themselves. Fair is fair.
Well, yeah, that's a good analogy.
I mean, if that's the mentality they're going to use, we can use it too.
Yes, we can.
But that's how they got here, by Tim giving an address as to here. But yet they Wilkinson stands in open court denying and saying that the government had no knowledge of Timothy McVeigh until April 21st.
Well, we know that is a lie because we know that Timothy McVeigh was under surveillance for quite some time before the Oklahoma Federal Building blew up.
Well...
Were you aware of that?
I have read that since I was released from prison a year ago in 2 days.
Uh-huh.
I have an anniversary coming up tomorrow and the next day.
Why do you think Timothy McVeigh would have been under surveillance by the government? Or by other people?
Because the only reason I can come up with is because he was at Waco, selling politically incorrect bumper stickers. He was too obvious, too out front, and he made sense. A highly decorated young man from the Gulf War, and he came directly from Waco to my house.
So you knew Tim McVeigh. How long before this catastrophe occurred did you know Tim McVeigh?
He came to visit here when my brother Terry was living here in late 91, early 92.
And that was because they were Army buddies?
Yeah. Terry just said an old Army buddy is coming to buy the visit.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
When did they leave the Army?
Terry left in, spring of 89, I believe.
And how about Terry?
Terry, that was Terry when he left.
Oh, Terry left.
Tim left just shortly in 91, I think, or something, or 90. I'm not sure exactly where.
Okay, were they together in the Gulf War?
No, Terry never went anywhere. He got a hardship discharge.
Uh-huh.
He had a 7 or 8 year old son there with him, and he was a chauffeur for one of the top brass there. And they were ordered to go to Germany, and they said, Nichols, we know what your situation is. We'll give you a dishonorable hardship discharge.
You better be careful now.
I a hardship discharge, to death straight, and they let him out, and he said, fine. Yeah, they let him out because he's a thinker, because he's a free thinker.
Uh-huh.
He wouldn't sit around doing nothing, and he was chewed out several times for doing something when he was supposed to be sitting doing nothing.
Well, I certainly understand.
Yeah, that's not what the Army wants.
No, it's not. It's not what any of the military services want.
And he was too bright, too smart. Get him out of there.
How deep was this friendship between Terry and Tim?
Well, they were good friends. I became good friends with Tim.
Uh-huh.
Tim stayed with me after Terry moved out in December of 93. Tim stayed for a couple more months.
Did you have any feeling at all at any time that either Tim or Terry, or Terry and Tim together, were involved in something that might lead to the bombing of the Muir Federal Building?
No, absolutely not. I wasn't aware. We were joking around. A neighbor called me at 11 o'clock that morning saying, hey, I hear they're raiding a farmhouse in Decker in the Palm of Michigan. They raiding your house? Oh, yeah, they're sitting out in the driveway waiting for me to come out of the house. Just jokingly.
Uh-huh.
And I look back at that day and I think, did the guy actually know something trying to warn me? No, he didn't know anything. Everyone knew in this whole thumb they were going to raid my house except me.
Wow.
I mean, people were trying to call me from uptown to tell me, hey, they're going to raid your house.
Uh-huh.
I was on the phone talking with the other neighbor.
Well, what happened that day? I mean, you...
No, I left at 2 o'clock, went to Marlette, 15 miles south, just to run some errands. I was gone for 1 hour. I came back, and I actually passed... It must have been some of the FBI or ATF in cars and didn't know it. And I didn't realize that they were heading north until I run into some media trucks.
Uh-huh.
Big satellite dish trucks and a helicopter. Half mile behind that was an ambulance screaming down the road. And I goes, wow, whoever it was, whoever house they're raiding, they already shot the guy. Because there goes the ambulance right behind the news trucks.
Uh-huh. So if you had been involved in the Oklahoma City Muir Federal Building bombing, if you had seen all of this happening, you certainly wouldn't have gone home, would you?
I came up the road, and 2 miles away I could see there was something going on.
Uh-huh.
At finally about half, three-quarters of a mile away, I could see they were at my house, and I just almost panicked, kind of into shock. Saying, wait a minute, they made a mistake. I've got to straighten this out,
Uh-huh.
Your first instinct is, man, I got to run. But it was, no, I've got to straighten this out. They made a mistake. They got the wrong house, the wrong address.
Well, I don't blame you for being afraid, especially after Waco, but...
And I said, wait a minute, I got to straighten this out.
Uh-huh.
And I pulled up there and no one knew. What's going on?
So they're all surrounding your house, guns pointed at your house, and you get out of your car and calmly walk up, and what did you say?
Well, I just, my window doesn't work on that driver's side, like good electric windows. And I just pointed my finger in this thing, come here, officer, state trooper.
Uh-huh.
Come over there, open my door up. I said, what's going on here? He said, who are you? I demanded, what's going on here? Who are you? I demanded. I said, I want to know what's going on here. Who are you? I live in that house right there, and this is a quarter of a mile away. It's a roadblock.
Uh-huh.
And he says, I identified myself. I said, now, I want to know what's going on here. He didn't know what to do. All the cameras were pointed at the house, and I'm going, gee, they don't even know what's going on here. this big guy here, the Decker bomber is... here at the corner, so close to everyone, everyone's looking at the house.
That sounds like a good movie.
Trooper officer stood there not knowing what to do. He didn't know whether to come and grab me or go get a couple FBI agents.
Uh-huh.
He stood there with his jaw hanging open going, back and forth. I says, they don't even know who they're looking for. I got out and identified myself again, and they searched me. And, are you armed? No, I'm not armed. And then they searched my car. Am I under arrest? No. And what do you got in the trunk? Normal stuff, a couple bags a week, taking over to the preacher to make bread with. I opened the trunk up, and they were so paranoid, real slow. And then they made a deal. Come on down the house. I want to talk to you. And we went through that scenario three times. Now, you're going to follow me right down the house. Yep, yep, I'm going to follow you. And we're going to call them on the radio, tell them you're coming. And we went through that scenario three times because I didn't want any mistakes.
Sure.
Didn't like what was going on. And I hopped in my car, and I went down, came down to my house. I didn't even get pulled off the road. And this JBT jumps into my car on the passenger side, pointing a gun at me, a rifle. Don't move. And I'm arguing with him, telling him, hey, I'm with these guys. They're right behind me, you know, and blah, blah. Didn't they call you on the radio? And blah, 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 you know. All they could do was yell, don't move. And I got real upset. Finally, it seemed like it took them forever, but they finally come along and say, hey, that's okay. He's with us. Leave him alone. He's okay. Let him out. Let him out. He's okay. I got out of the car, and I just said, what the hell is going on here? I thought you said you was going to be right behind me. I thought you said you was going to call him on the radio. Oh, we forgot. It's a long way to forget.
You think they were hoping somebody would do something stupid?
I really got suspicious, and I was real careful after that because I didn't like the way things was. That was a setup, I felt. It was just, I didn't like what was going on there. The guy was awful trigger happy.
Well, let's go back to my original point, James. If you had had any part in blowing up the Muir Federal Building in Oklahoma City, you would not have gone up to that roadblock and identified yourself and asked why they're around your house.
No, I wouldn't. If I blew up something like that, I wouldn't have been here, period.
And by the same token, if Tim McVeigh had had anything to do with the explosion at the Muir Federal Building and he was armed, do you think he would allow himself to be disarmed and arrested by one patrol officer on the highway?
No way. He'd have wasted him and drove away.
Now, this is a trained, combat-experienced Army veteran who has killed people before.
Yes, yes. He wouldn't. I know Tim McVeigh, I think, well enough to where he would not have put my name down as supposedly next of kin or someone to contact in case of emergency or something. He put my address, which was on his driver's license, his address, and he put person of contact, or it says next of kin, and he put James Nichols, friend.
Uh-huh.
If he was in trouble into something like that, he would not involve an innocent person and get them involved in any way, shape, or form, knowingly.
Uh-huh. Yeah, now, let me ask you a point blank. Do you?
He would take his punishment and shut up, not drag innocent people into it.
Well, that's certainly the feeling of a lot of his old Army buddies, is that Tim would have taken whatever fell on his shoulders like a man and would not have implicated anybody else.
That's right.
This is what they all tell us.
But that's part of the problem right now also. We're being kept from communicating, me, myself, and my buddy Bob.
From communicating with who, James?
Timothy McVeigh. We cannot communicate with him. We send letters to him. I filled out a form the middle of April to get on his telephone calling list, be approved.
Uh-huh.
I haven't received any phone calls from him yet. I keep telling him to call me. Bob keeps writing letters to him, telling him to call us, call me, write us, anything. And Jones is playing games with him. Things are not right.
What do you think about Jones?
He's a capable attorney, but I don't trust him.
Do you know his history?
A little bit.
You know, he is famous for defending communists, radicals, people who have, Angela Davis, for one.
That's Stephen Jones?
Yeah.
Well, Mike Tiger kind of has the same reputation, I was told.
Why do you think these people are defending Timothy McVeigh?
Well, we just don't trust Jones, and we've told him right to his face.
Uh-huh.
And we would rather remain enemies and see Terry and Tim walk free than remain friends and see him fried. We've talked with Stephen Jones on many occasions, and we don't know if we can trust him. Michael Tiger is much better. He's more likable, more trustworthy.
Well, if the people that we believe actually blew up the Mura Federal Building, did in fact blow it up, then Jones has a history of being at their beck and call. He has always been the one that the Communist Party goes to defend their people when they're in trouble. What do you think about that?
I'm not sure if I understand you totally there. I know Jones is kind of a government man, so to speak, and I've seen him perform in Oklahoma and seen him perform in Denver. And the job that he done in Denver in April was much better than anything I saw in Oklahoma.
Mm-hmm.
Whether he's out of the reach of Governor Keating there or what, I don't know. He feels a little more freer or what. But he's done a much better job in Denver than he done in Oklahoma.
Now, why would a private practicing attorney be under the control of Governor Keating?
Well, he's Governor Keating's personal counsel. I've seen a plaque on his wall in his office.
Oh, boy. It gets deeper and deeper, doesn't it?
Yes.
Oh, brother. Well,
Who had the power and the authority to fill in the crater out there by the building? And who had the authority to take the building down and destroy the evidence and haul it away? It certainly wasn't Mr. Jones or Mr. Tiger or Terry or Tim, the defense did at all. The government did.
Well, that's true. We all know that, and they shouldn't have. It's destruction of evidence. It's a perversion of justice. It's all kinds of things.
Right, right, right. A lot of people in America, they're starting to come around, but there's a lot of them that need to be woken up yet.
Tell me about it. Listen, James, let me ask you point blank. Do you believe, or do you have any reason to believe, or do you think at all that Tim McVeigh and or either one or together Terry Nichols had anything to do with the bombing of the Mura Federal Building in any capacity whatsoever?
Terry did not have anything to do with it. Tim may have been, and I say may have been involved in a sting operation and made to be the fall guy.
Well, your opinion certainly parallels our research.
I mean, what we've been seeing and what we've been hearing with Hoppy Heidelberg being kicked off the grand jury.
Well, that's strictly because of Larry Myers' machinations.
Yes, yes. Very intriguing, laying of a trap or a very elusive plan.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, there's something funny there, too. From the moment I met Larry Myers, I just said, Bob, he's a government agent.
He's slick, isn't he?
I sat talking to him for 4 hours one day at a restaurant and talking to him. Bob done a lot of talking. I'd listened and analyzed. And that man tried to look right through me. And I just said, he's a government man. He ain't getting anything out of me. I mean, he done a nice article on Tim, and I think it was the February issue, where I told Lawrence about the accident that Tim stopped at, and actually it kind of embarrassed Jones a little bit.
Uh-huh.
He didn't know about it either.
Well, that's not what we understand. We understand that Jones allowed him to interview
But Jones,
and to write that article in exchange for something else.
Yes, but Jones didn't know anything about this incident.
Which incident was that?
Where Tim stopped on I-70 along the Indiana-Illinois border and helped save a guy, or put an IV in him, and they've blown it up, I think, a little bit, credited him with saving the guy's life. 1990, I think it was. And Tim was surprised that anyone knew about it. He only told two or three people.
Uh-huh.
And we keep telling Jones that we can help. We can help. And he won't let us. He doesn't want our help. and we can't talk to him. He won't let us communicate with Tim. Tim called me the 23rd of August, complaining to me that they were confiscating all his mail. He wasn't getting any of it.
He's not getting any mail at all?
At that time.
Is he getting mail now?
Yes. Supposedly, he hasn't mentioned anything lately. I'm on this phone list now, but he hasn't called.
Uh-huh.
And that's the thing that worries me. I just think he's been set up.
You think he'll make it to trial?
Yeah, I think so. He's made it this far. We were really worried about that in Oklahoma.
Well, we were worried about it, too.
And especially the transfer.
Mm-hmm.
Terry told us about the transfer when he was out there in April, and it was a real joke. Laughable situation, he said.
What happened?
Well, they jumped into a bus, and they only had 100 feet to go, and they tried to move the bus, and the air had leaked out of the brake system, and it wouldn't move, so they had to pull it up with a squad car. He says it was a joke. Government gone haywire.
Wow.
Security, people standing around at 3 o'clock in the morning. Oh, they jumped in the squad car, and only one officer in the back with them. Down where he's gone. They only went 100 feet and into the building, and he said it was a real joke.
James, did you ever meet this man who's described as John Doe number 2?
No.
Do you have any idea who this person might be?
No. No, only that he must certainly exist because there's enough people.
I can guarantee you he exists.
I believe that too, like Hoppy Heidelberg does.
There's no doubt that he exists.
But the problem is, when I was being interrogated the April 21st a year ago, last year, by the statements that the FBI made to me to try to get me to talk more and tell them more, or make up more stories, I guess, I came to the conclusion by what they said that someone had been watching us for a long time.
I've told you already, we know for a fact, we have irrefutable proof that Tim McVeigh and John Doe number 2 were under surveillance for months before the Mura Federal Building was blown up.
I'm talking 2 years.
Well, it could be. We have proof that they were definitely under surveillance for months.
From the day that Tim McVeigh left Waco and came here, we were all under surveillance. And because of the paperwork that we filed in the local courthouse, we became prime suspects for conviction in the media, to convict us in the media as government haters, and they wouldn't even have to hold trial.
So you know yourself that you were under surveillance, Tim McVeigh was under surveillance, and your brother Terry?
Time it was going on.
Pardon?
Not at the time it was going on, but since the raid, yes.
How do you know if you didn't know at the time that it was going on?
Because I've read some articles and things where certain people have admitted that, yes, they've been watching Tim McVeigh for over 2 years.
Yes, well,
they knew that he was going to do something like this.
I think they knew exactly what was going to happen.
And they knew if they were watching Tim McVeigh for over 2 years, they were also watching me and Terry.
Uh-huh.
Because we were also here. Tim was here sometimes.
Yeah, well, let me tell you what our investigation has brought forward. We believe that they were not only under surveillance, but that John Doe number 2 was most probably the instigator of the whole thing and is a paid government informant or agent or provocateur, and that they allowed this whole thing to happen, just like the FBI helped them make the bomb and set it up and detonate it at the World Trade Center in New York City.
Right, yes.
And that it was going to be a big sting-like thing that would give them a lot of glory and shuck off all of the disgrace from Waco, and they screwed up. I believe that the bomb was supposed to go off before the people got to work, and for some reason, nothing was coordinated.
Yes.
What do you think?
I believe somewhat, quite a bit of that. I think there was actually some bombs placed inside by an intelligence organization, CIA, NSA, who knows what.
Well, it wouldn't have been the NSA, because they don't do that kind of thing. They monitor communications and decipher code. But the CIA is not above such things. They've been doing those things for many, many years. That's their...
Oh, yes, and look what's happened to William Colby.
Uh-huh.
Gee, what's that?
Well, you know, he died of a heart attack while canoeing, don't you?
Didn't.
No.
They're planned. But we suspect that someone was impersonating Tim. We're pretty sure of that from our little investigation that we've done. And the people we've talked to in Oklahoma and like that. Terry, we suspect someone was impersonating him once or twice, a couple times. And at one time, they were saying when this thing first started, that they were saying that I was, and they had witnesses of all three of us out there in Kansas and like that. And it turns out that I have such good alibis and witnesses and bills of sale and phone records that it was totally impossible for me to be out there. I had perfect alibis, and I don't like using the word alibis.
An alibi merely means a story for where you were.
Yes, but I...
Nothing disgraceful about that.
No, but I don't like their words. I was here, and we've happened to run across some articles of saying that a man at a motel out there... had someone check into the motel using my name, and I'm going, my theory is starting to come to light, to truth.
So you think that there were several different McVeighs and Terry Nichols, just like there were several different Oswalds?
Well, there was at least two McVeighs and at least one Terry, and I think they was having somebody impersonate me, too. But when they found out that I had the perfect alibis with actual witnesses every night for a week before the bombing, they dropped that like a hot potato. They wouldn't even talk about it anymore. The FBI wouldn't.
Everybody we've talked with tells us that Tim McVeigh is an extremely intelligent individual. Do you believe that he would drive a getaway car with no license plate?
No way. No way. He wouldn't do that. Terry or I, we might do that. I would do it. I mean, a car without a plate on it. I just done it the other night.
We're getting away from the scene of a crime?
No.
Well, that's...
Absolutely not. Is he that much of a martyr? If he was, he would have shot the cop. You know, if he's such a hater, like they say. I know him better than that.
Yeah.
Things don't fit. Tim Combat parks his car. Now, I've parked for 20 years and didn't know what it was until Tim came along and told me, oh, you combat park, huh? What? What are you talking about? That's my normal parking mode.
What are you talking about?
Well, when you go to park in a parking lot somewhere, you go to the bar or something, or shopping, you always park with your license plate against the trees or the bushes or a building or something.
Uh-huh.
So that you drive out of the parking spot, not have to back out. Called combat, as jokingly it's called combat parking.
Uh-huh.
So you can just hop in your car and make a fast getaway.
So a guy with no license plate would have no need to do that, would he?
Well,
except to not have to turn around or back out and maneuver.
If you combat park, you don't pass your license plate getting in your vehicle. Someone else has a chance to take it off because they know that you combat park. And you're not going to go around back to see if you got a plate on, because you know you always got one.
Uh-huh.
And it's very convenient. You drive away not knowing you don't have a plate on.
Why do you think he would always park like that? What was the purpose of that?
I've done it for 20 years and not known it. It's just, around here we do it because the cops just systematically go through the bar parking lot and get every patron there is, sooner or later. Everyone gets their turn. So you try to protect yourself by backing against the building so they can't get your plate number.
I see. So it doesn't have anything to do with getting away quick?
No. It's just, I've always parked my pickup like that because you got to back up sooner or later. If you're in a hurry to go to town to get a park because you got 5 minutes, you jump in it and you go. You don't want to be fooling around backing up.
Mm-hmm.
I'll take my time and back up in the spot that I park in when I park it there.
Now, there's some stories being touted around that you guys built some bombs and blew them up on your farm. Is that true?
There was pop bottle bombs made.
And what do you mean by pop bottle bombs?
There were some chemicals mixed together and just in a plastic a pint-sized bottle, 20-ounce bottles, and just thrown out in the driveway, and some of them blew up and some of them didn't.
And what was the purpose of that, James?
Kids play. and it really wasn't him and Terry that were doing it. It was another man and Terry doing it.
Uh-huh.
And I said, you guys are acting like kids. I went and done something different, you know. I made a little pill vial bomb to loosen my soybeans up to get them out of the grain bin in April of 94. That's common practice among farmers that have grain bins and have trouble when they can't get their grain out. And I made it out of black powder, Pyridex, synthetic black powder for your muzzleloader. And that's what they tried to hammer me with, making the pop out of bombs and that little bomb. But I didn't use it to harm anyone or threaten anybody or damage anybody's property. Bad thing is, the same thing that I was charged with, there have been many, many people served prison time for the exact same thing. And there is no law there.
You say there is no law. What do you mean? No law against doing it?
Yes. It's only a commerce statute. Title 26, Section 5861. Where's the Code of Federal Regulations to implement that statute?
Well, they don't care.
That's right.
They don't care anymore.
That's how we challenged them.
Yeah.
And they backed off. And it's very plain and obvious what it says. Any person involved in the business of as a dealer, manufacturer, or importer, got to do 14 other paragraphs. That's not me. But their lawyers pleaded them out. But that's what happens. The Supreme Court decides that the law is unconstitutional. They leave it on the books, and their lawyers will plead you out.
Huh.
A sad shame. But I was smart enough. I have read enough law to get me in trouble and know how to get out a little bit.
Well, good for you.
With the help of a lot of others.
How is Terry taking this? We have seen photographs and heard testimony that from witnesses that Terry, when he has appeared in public in the courtroom, is like somebody in another world. It's like he's a zombie or something. Is that true?
Terry is a very private, reserved, calm individual. Very sober, very serious all the time. It's hard to have a conversation with him when he don't want to talk.
So you think that this is a normal condition for him?
Yeah, it's normal. He's upset because I just talked. He called me last Saturday. He's upset because they're still saying on a week ago when Mike Tiger was on Nightline, and they're still saying they said I said this and that at the Harrington Police Department. Because I never said that. And they're still promoting misinformation, the government is.
Well, James, I got to say, there's nothing new about that.
No.
That seems to be their stock in trade, lies, deception, manipulation.
I was watching the Randy Weaver special tonight, second half, and that brings back a lot of memories of how they lied to the family. That brings a lot of memories back of last year when they lied to government. The FBI lied to my mother and my sister and my brother and everybody around here. And it really affected them bad. And I just said, look, believe in your heart. You know I haven't done anything. And then they tried to turn them against me. And I said, start asking questions. They're lying to you. I don't have any reason to lie. And they finally start seeing, and boy, when they found the truth out, did they get mad. Now they've got a bunch more of government haters on their hands, so to speak.
Well, I don't think any of us, none of us hate the government. The government is the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. We hate these scum-sucking, lying, puke-faced, communist, socialist pigs that are in control of our government now, these Nazi jackbooted thugs who murder people and destroy people and think nothing of any of it.
And no one is held responsible for it.
That's right. In fact, they're given medals and promoted.
Yes, yes.
It's sickening.
There's a very interesting thing about the Oklahoma there is the one witness, David Snyder, that saw the second Ryder truck at approximately the same time and everything.
Uh-huh.
Different Ryder truck.
Uh-huh.
And he was interviewed by Bob Ricks and the other guy in charge of Oklahoma. I think Kennedy is his name.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, Bob Ricks, you know, quite a while ago, no longer works for the FBI. He works for the governor and for the state of Oklahoma.
Uh-huh.
Public safety commissioner or something like that.
Yes.
I just have a question of what happened to the 302 of the interview with David Snyder. Did it go with Bob Ricks, or what happened to it? How can you interview a man, a witness, an eyewitness, in 10 minutes? We interviewed him, and it takes 20 minutes to half an hour, at least.
Well, it should, if you're going to really go after facts and truth.
And they spent 10 minutes with him, and never talked with him again.
And no record?
Well, that remains to be seen. I'm going to ask to see it, to specifically bring it up when they get the computers working well, the defense attorneys like that,
mm-hmm.
with the CD-ROMs like that, see what they actually put down, because they didn't take him to the grand jury or anything. You know, it's the whole thing. That's wrong.
So you don't think Terry was involved in this at all?
No.
And you think Tim might have been, but if he was, he was, what, a patsy?
More or less unknowingly involved. Yeah, he was used as a patsy. He's been set up as a patsy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, definitely.
What makes you think that Tim may have been involved?
Well, he may not have been. But I say that's he may have a little bit, but I hate saying that.
Well, I understand why you would hate
someone was impersonating him.
Uh-huh.
It's real obvious.
Well, we know that is true. We know that someone was impersonating Timothy McVeigh. There's no doubt about that.
Right.
We haven't found any reason to believe that anybody was impersonating Terry Nichols, but we may run across that at a later time. And in fact, I'm going to have Michelle talk to you about that, and we'll run that down. But
maybe Tim just drove a truck to Oklahoma and hopped in his car and took off. Maybe somebody else impersonated him right to the very last minute or something.
Did you ever hear Tim mention the name of somebody named William Taylor?
Not that I can remember.
Daniel Spiegelman?
Not that I can remember.
Okay.
William Taylor is a common name around here. I've known ones locally, I think, or something like that.
Okay. What do you think about the way that Tim and Terry are being treated in prison?
Well, when they were being treated in Oklahoma, it was very harsh. No physical contact visits. And they the guards were not even nice out there. I mean, they were halfway nice, but the whole situation has improved 100% in Denver. The guards in Denver, from my visit out there, it's been a lot better. The guards just even sit there and say, look, we don't even know if he's guilty of anything.
Well, that's the way the whole nation should be looking at it. He hasn't been convicted of any crime, either one of them.
Exactly, but the Oklahoma situation is so... The guards were you know, they were affected also. I mean, even the governor was just, they got something to cover up. Someone does. You know, the governor something. By his actions and what he has said and things, the outrage that he's, and the emotions that he has stirred up, stuff.
Well, isn't Governor Keating the one who claims to have been the first one to find the axle with the serial number that supposedly led to the Ryder truck in which the alleged explosives were housed?
That's what I heard.
Well, that was the announcement on the news that the news made. He said that he found it. Later on, when it became too much for anybody to believe that the governor would just stumble over this axle and find the serial number that led to the suspects, all of a sudden this other guy comes forward, this real slick policeman who obviously had been trained in media techniques, and he tells the story about how he found it.
Yeah. There's too many coincidences.
Have you had a chance to look into the manuscript that Governor Keating's brother wrote, which outlines almost exactly the same thing that happened to the Muir Federal Building?
No, I haven't seen any of the printing of it, but I've heard about excerpts of it like that.
Uh-huh.
But no, I haven't.
Do you think it's a coincidence that the lead character was named McVeigh?
No. Now, who was he talking to? Supposedly McVeigh was up in the Murrah Building the week before or something, 2 days before the bombing, talking to Dr. forget his name. That man, Dr. Heath, I think it is, actually came out here to Michigan and was interviewing people around within 6 miles of my dad's house.
For what?
Good question. That is what he told my dad in the bathroom in Oklahoma in the courthouse one day. And I just said, well, did you ask him why? Why is he out in Michigan interviewing people about, I guess, us, the Nichols family? I don't know. I find that very suspicious, you know? Something's up. I don't know.
What do you think's going to happen, James?
Boy, it's anybody's guess. Yet, if the truth comes out, I know they're going to have they've got an awful, awful hard time of getting a conviction on anyone. Terry, we're pretty sure is going to walk. Tim, I don't know, because we don't get to talk to him. They're keeping him totally isolated away from anyone, everyone except media people. And they're not helping him, which we have objected to very strongly, strong as we can. I know what they're doing. They're doing psychological warfare. They have done it since day one, try to break these guys down to get them to admit to something so they can prosecute them.
Uh-huh. So you think they're telling one that the other one squealed, and they're telling the other one that the other one squealed on him, and working all these good guy, bad guy, your buddies turned against you and all this stuff?
It's like 48, you know. There's a guy that's, you know, the government said, oh, he's a confessed liar, and then that's just their star witness. I pity the poor guy because he's not going to hold up under cross-examination with Jones and Tiger, especially Tiger. He'll tear him apart. And if the guy is guilty and helped in the so-called planning of the bombing and casing the joint like he has admitted to and things, and they found him guilty, why haven't they sentenced him? They're holding that over his head, telling him, if you don't perform well, this trial doesn't go well, you don't stick to your story and make it believable, you're going to go to prison for longer than, what is it, 23 or 26 years?
Well, that's a normal trick that they use all the time.
Right. But why don't they send him and get on with the whole show?
I don't know. I don't know a lot of things that I would like to know.
that's the thing. If we all knew the truth, we'd all be better off.
Did you ever meet Fortier?
No.
What's his first name?
Michael Fortier.
Michael Fortier. Have you ever seen him without a beard?
I've never seen a picture of him until I see him on television, I think.
Well, did he have a beard?
I think so, then, or goatee.
Yeah, when he was arrested, he had a beard, full beard.
Was it a beard?
Yeah.
I know he had some hair there, but... Now, I've never seen a picture of him, I don't think, unless it was just, you know, something that Tim had, just casual, you know.
Yeah, so you never met him at all?
No, no.
Do you think he could be John Doe number two?
No. No.
What makes you say no?
Too skinny. Not dark complected enough. I mean, according to the pictures and everything we've seen, the witnesses, unless you got some better information. You know, I'm clearer out here in Michigan, and you guys are closer to it than I am.
Oh, we have all kinds of information that nobody even knows yet, and a lot of it's going to come out with this first volume of the book that we're writing. But the real devastating evidence for the government is contained in Volume 1 and Volume 2, which is... It's going to knock their legs right out from under them. They're lying on almost everything that they've ever said.
Oh, yes, they've fabricated everything.
Yes.
Everything. And the people are going to have a hard time accepting that. Some will, some won't.
Well, in light of the evidence, you see, we're not just saying it. We documented it.
Right. I realize that. You guys have done an excellent job. I love Michelle for what she's done there, and you... I wish we could do the same.
Well,
it takes time.
Well, it takes dedicated people who are willing to sacrifice in order to get the job done. That's what it takes.
And praying that someone that has seen something would step forward and could prove more yet.
Yes.
That's
well,
what we need.
They will, and they do, a few at a time, here and there, they come forward.
Yes.
And when they do, we document it, and we back it up with testimony from other people who've come forward. None of them know each other or about each other, and it's devastating. They all tell the same story. The government is lying on almost everything they've ever said from day one right up to the present time.
What I want is some of the government agents and officers to step forward.
Well, I doubt if you're gonna see that.
Wasn't it William Colby that brought the attention to the American people to what the CIA done? And blew the whistle on them a little bit.
No, William Colby was practicing damage control, and what they did is they threw the poor dog a bone instead of the steak that he deserved. And so the public felt that the truth was told and the investigation was complete, and they slapped a couple of wrists, and that was it. Colby did his job. He protected the agency by throwing out a couple of bones. That's the typical method of handling the public in those cases when they know that there's something to hide and they've got to assuage the public that they've been that it's been dealt with.
Yeah, right.
And the same thing happened in the Waco investigation. They made the public feel like the Congress looked into it and the truth came out, and then guess what happened? Nothing.
Right, nothing.
Nothing ever happens.
Right.
They threw the poor dog a bone. And the poor dog, not realizing that there's a whole ham hock and a whole side of beef in the refrigerator, accepted the bone.
Right. Right.
Gleefully. James, we just got a couple more minutes to go. What would you like to tell the American people that you haven't told them? Or what needs to be told? Or what would you like to have say on behalf of Terry or Tim? Or
just that we need someone, more people to step forward. They have no reason to be scared. I've been there. There's no reason to be scared. What are they going to do, throw you in jail? When you show no fear, they can't scare you anymore.
By golly, I've been trying to teach the American people that for a long time.
And people just leave, you know. Well, aren't you afraid of what you're going to say? They might throw you back in jail. What are they going to do? Throw me in prison? I've already been there. And it doesn't scare me. That's the thing. And I'm just an everyday common citizen like anyone else. I may be a little outspoken, but I didn't ask to be outspoken. I was a little bit outspoken before. I'm outspoken where Terry's quieter.
Uh-huh.
But if you ask me what I think, I tell you. A lot of people don't like that. But we need the truth in this country. The truth will set us free. That's what we need.
Why do you think, with so little evidence against Terry, that he's being held in such maximum security?
Because I was held the same way.
Why?
Because it's a big case. One of the biggest cases in history.
But they have such little evidence. I mean, they can't even prove, really, that Terry did anything.
Right, I know.
In fact, I can't even figure out how they justify holding him.
Well, no one can, especially his attorneys. Same thing happened to me. There was no due process. Denied bail, no charges, fictitious informant that they would never name. And
I can name him. It's John Doe number two.
Well, I mean, that testified that I was doing things, informant up here in Michigan.
Oh, okay. Well, there's several informants involved in this, and there's a whole surveillance team. And we believe that the ADL is probably deeply involved.
Absolutely. I was being stalked last November by them, I believe. But they picked the wrong time to come watch me. It was deer hunting time. People get shot all the time.
Well, now, I'm not for shooting anybody.
No, but hunters get shot all the time. I catch anybody stalking me, and I will catch them.
And let's not...
No.
Let's not say anything that might get you thrown back in there.
No, the sheriff will be summoned, and they will have to identify themselves, or that someone's going to jail.
Yeah.
And I will call the militia, even though I'm not part of them.
Well, good for you. We're out of time, James, and I want to thank you for being our guest tonight. If you don't feel that you got out what you wanted to get out, or if you think that there's something else that we need to talk about, you call me or call Michelle, and we'll do this again real soon.
Talk again.
Okay?
Yes, Bill.
Thank you so much.
It's been a very good talk.
And tell Terry and Tim, if you can, that... we don't know whether they're guilty or not, but we're trying our best to find out who is.
I'm going to send the subscription in for them for Veritas tomorrow.
Wonderful.
They can get it.
And then Larry Myers can print that they read in my newspaper. Good night, James.
Thank you, Bill. Good night.
And good night, folks. And God bless each and every single one of you. Mm-hmm.